My name's Caroline. I'm a journalist. I've got a two-part question here. Does Islam propagate acts of forgiveness? Yes or no? Does Islam propagate acts of forgiveness?
To start the question, does Islam propagate acts of forgiveness? Of course, yes. And every chapter, every surah of the glorious Quran begins with the formula, Bismillah Rahman Rahim. In the name of Allah, most gracious, most merciful.
So why does it...
Yes, sister. Second part of the question.
And the second part of the question is, why does Islam permit honor killings?
Honor killing?
Yes.
What do you mean by honor killing, sister?
Honor killing, the right to avenge your brother's blood in the name of Allah. It might be out of context, but I just need to know if there's an answer to this.
If I get you, mean honor killing means if someone kills any human being to take revenge?
Yes.
That's what you mean?
Yes, because I've read a few books and a lot of the times people have said that they are allowed to kill their brother or to kill somebody else because their brother has been killed by another human being.
This was also a good question, that if Islam propagates act of forgiveness, why does it permit honor killing?
Yes.
Why does it permit? That's a very good question. Sister, if you analyze this mention in the Quran in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse 178, the hath penalty, the punishment of death, on the basis of qisas. And Allah also says in the Quran in Surah Maida, chapter number 5, verse number 32, if anyone kills any other human being, whether it be Muslim or non-Muslim, unless it be for murder or for creating mischief in the land, it is as though he has killed the whole of humanity. So as a general rule, if any human being kills any other human being, it is as though he has killed the whole of humanity, except under two circumstances, unless it is for murder or for creating mischief in the land. Now, there are two exceptions where Islam gives permission where you can kill any other human being. Number one is, if that person has committed murder, which comes in your scope of question, honor killing. Number two is if he is creating fasad, corruption in this land. Again, this is not compulsory. If someone kills someone, it's not compulsory he has to be killed. Islam also says that if the relatives of the person who has been killed, if they take blood money, if they forgive the killer, that person who has killed can be forgiven. But under normal circumstances, if he's killed someone and if I want death on that, because for death, again, the punishment is death. Like as it's mentioned earlier in the early scriptures, even in the Bible, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth, it keeps on continuing. Here what we realize, that suppose I know of a human being who's killing other people, innocent human being. If I don't kill him, he will keep on killing other human beings. So that law is not only in Islam, it's the law of most of the countries, that if homicide is done, if someone has murdered someone, in many countries, he should be put to death or their life imprisonment. Even in Islam, that if he's killed someone, if required, he can be killed. But the relatives of the person even can forgive the person if they want. If they want, they can forgive the murderer. But if they want that he should be put to death, then he'll be put to death. And the second case where a person can be killed is if he's causing corruption in the land. For example, if someone is committing rape. Now, rape is nothing but causing corruption in the land. So in this case, that person should be put to death. Because the sin is so heinous, it is such a big crime that there's no other punishment but death penalty. And I've asked this to many non-Muslims, that God forbid, if someone rapes your mother, and if you are made the judge, and the rapist is born in front of you, what punishment will you give him? And 100% of the non-Muslims, they told me that we will put him to death. Some went to the extreme of saying we will torture him to death. So why the double standards? You know, in America, which happens to be one of the most advanced countries in the world, according to the FBI statistics, in 1990, every day on average, 1,756 cases of rape took place. According to 1996 statistics, US Department of Justice, every day 2,713 cases of rape took place. 1990, 1,756. 1996, 2,713. Maybe the Americans got more bold. That means every 32 second, one rape is taking place in America. We are here in this auditorium for the past about 3 hours. Already more than 300 rapes may have taken place in America. So Islam has a system of hijab, which I mentioned in my talk, that when a man looks at a woman, he should lower the gaze. The woman should follow the Islamic hijab, which I mentioned earlier. After that, if any man commits rape, he gets capital punishment. Even the American law says that 7 years rigorous imprisonment for a rapist, but most of the time he's let free. So when you ask even a non-Muslim what punishment will you give, 100% said we'll put him to death. There was one American who was a smart aleck. In America, he told me, Brother Zakir, first I will give him 5 years rigorous imprisonment. I told him, do you know, according to the statutes of America, out of those that commit rape, after the imprisonment, after they're let free, more than 95% commit rape again. So if you want your daughter and your mother to be raped again, you're most welcome. I don't want that. So he said, if that's the case, in the first time, it's a problem to death. So in such cases, where there's corruption of land like rape, etc., Islam gives permission, death penalty can even be given for that case. Hope that answers the question, sister.
Yes, brother.
Assalamu alaikum, sir. My name is Praveen Kumar, and I am a computer programmer by profession. First of all, I would like to thank you for delivering such a wonderful lecture. And my question is, from your presentation, it's very crystal clear that whatever the righteous path set in the Islam, it's also set in the Christianity. So why not a Muslim or a Christian take up both and take the good deeds in both the things and follow it?
The brother asked a very good question and a very important question, and a chance to clarify my talk also. Asked a very good question. That if everything is good, I've talked about similarities in Islam and Christianity, everything is good, so why don't we take the good of the religion? That's what I've done. I've taken the good of Christianity, that is the Bible. I can give a talk, a longer talk, differences in Islam and Christianity, which I don't intend doing. There are many things which I don't agree with the Bible. Many things, because I don't consider the Bible as a whole to be the word of God. We believe in the Injil which was revealed to Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. But the present Bible is a corrupted form of the original revelation which was given to Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. This Bible, if we analyze, has got hundreds of contradictions, has got hundreds of mathematical errors, has got many scientific errors. I had a debate with Dr. William Campbell, Quran and the Bible in the light of science, and I pointed out many scientific errors. These scientific errors, these contradictions cannot be attributed to Almighty God. There is even pornography in this Bible, which if you ask me to read, even if you pay me $1 million, I can't read in front of the public. Pornography. Ezekiel chapter number 23, and I can quote the references, but I cannot read it. I cannot. Islam doesn't give me permission. So what I have done, brother, I have followed the guidance of the Quran of Surah Al-Imran, chapter 3, verse 64, which says, Ta'ala wila kalmitin sawa im bainana bainakum. Come to common terms as between us and you. At least what is common, we agree to follow. What is not common, we'll discuss it later on. See, when we have an interfaith dialogue, I disagree with the way interfaith dialogue takes place in different parts of the world. There is a Christian who comes and says, all religion are good, Islam is good, Christianity is good, Hinduism is good. Then a Hindu comes and says, Islam is good, Christianity is good, Hinduism is good. Then a Muslim comes and says, Islam is good, Christianity is good, Hinduism is good. Then when I ask the question, will that Christian priest give up Christianity and accept Islam if both are the same? The answer is no. Will the Hindu give up his religion and become a Christian? The answer is no. Will the Muslim give his religion and become a Hindu? The answer is no. It is nothing but hogwash. What I have done, I ask the people, at least let us agree, that one scripture in the world is 100% the word of God. No one will have problem in that. The Hindu will say, okay, I don't mind accepting my scripture, the Veda, to be the word of God. 100% correct. The Christian will say, I have got no problem. I wouldn't mind accepting Bible to be the word of God. The Muslim will say, I have got no problem. I wouldn't mind accepting Quran to be the word of God. Now, take out the common factors in all these major world religious scriptures. At least agree to follow what is common. All the major world religions, they say there's one God. They say idol worship is wrong. All the major world religious scriptures say that the last and final messenger to come is Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So when we analyze, I say, let us at least agree to follow what is common. All the major religions speak about modesty, even Hinduism. And earlier when I'd come to Dubai last year, I gave a talk on similarities between Hinduism and Islam. Even Hinduism says there's one God. Idol worship is prohibited. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is going to come. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is mentioned more than 100 places in the Hindu scripture. Even Hindu scripture says that you should be modest. The woman should be completely covered. There should be covered. Polygamy is allowed in Hinduism, in Christianity, as well as in Islam, about modesty, not to have alcohol, not to gamble. That doesn't mean everything of Hinduism is correct. Similarly, everything what today the Christians follow is not correct. What I have done, I have used the Furqan. Quran is the Furqan, the criteria to judge right from wrong. What is matching with the Quran, I have got no objection in accepting that to be correct. What contradicts, I disagree. There is certain things mentioned in the Bible, the prophets did incest with the daughter. Now, how can I agree that Prophet Lut, alayhi salam, Prophet Lot, did incest with his daughter? I can't agree with that. What I say, this portion cannot be the word of God. It is adulteration. It is a corruption. It's a fabrication. Therefore, I'm saying that if you read the Bible, there's something like the red letter Bible. This is a red letter Bible. Red letter means all the words that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, spoke are in red. And if you compile them, it will hardly be two columns of the newspaper. Very little, a small percentage. What I'm trying to tell, that at least let us agree to follow what is common. That doesn't mean I agree everything of the Bible. Because today's Bible is not maintained in the original form. Why? Because all the previous scriptures, as I mentioned in my talk, were supposed to be meant for those people and for that time. Today, you have to follow the last and final message, that is the glorious Quran, and the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Irrespective whether they're born in India or Pakistan or America or UK or UAE or Saudi Arabia, you have to follow the last and final revelation, the Quran, and the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. You tell me to take the good points, I've taken the good points of Christianity. As far as Islam is concerned, I don't know a single bad point. You point out to me and I will give you the reply. I challenge anyone to point out a single verse of the Quran which is against humanity. Don't point out the Muslims. I'm not here to support the Muslims. I'm here talking about Islam. To understand Islam, don't look at the Muslims. Look at the Quran and the authentic hadith, the sayings of the Prophet. And I challenge anyone to point out a single statement in the Quran or the hadith which is against humanity. There may be certain statements you may feel is wrong because of lack of knowledge, not having the statistics of the world. But inshallah, if you think anything is wrong, you're most welcome to point out. And I will try and explain to you why this is there in Islam, the reason and the hikmah behind it.